thanks Pitbull Audio for having us out here today. We've got some cool stuff going on. We've got Sammy Boller here, who is a ridiculous guitar player from Detroit. So give it up for Sammy, everybody. This is going to be really, really cool. After Sammy, we've got somebody, nobody here probably ever heard of him, a little guy named Steve Stevens. Anybody familiar? Eh? No? No? Nah, of course not. No, so Steve's going to come up. Dave Friedman is here, so anybody here who has questions about amplifiers or tone or anything nerdy, now's your chance. It's going to be awesome. Anyways, enough from me. I'm going to let Sammy get to it. All right, everybody, enjoy.
Cool. So I'm going to play for about 20 minutes, and we'll bring Steve up, all right? Cheers, guys. Thank you guys so much.
Oh, man. Everybody, one more for Sammy. Goodness. Wow. I should have spent more time practicing. I'll tell you.
Thanks, man.
All right, I wanted to let everybody know we've got a merch table set up in the back. There's all kinds of stuff that Steve brought with him, some cool stuff back there. We're also doing a giveaway. We've got a Friedman BEOD Deluxe, which is a two-channel preamp pedal. He's holding it right back there. It's the same voice that's basically inside of the BE100 Deluxe there in a two-button pedal format. So there are raffle tickets in the back. Just go ahead, and if you haven't already taken one of those, go ahead and do it. Now, if you could do me a favor, give it up for Steve Stevens. He's coming on next. Come on, everybody. Make him feel good.
All right. How's everybody doing? Thank you for coming out. I know it's raining, and it's a little bit of a haul to come in here. But give it up for Sammy Boller. That's a hard act to follow, to be honest. He's awesome. And he's the nicest guy as well. So he's Dave's absolutely best ambassador. So what I'll do is I'll play a couple of things for you. Sammy and I actually spent a day together, and we came up with an original tune that we'll play together. And then I'll take some questions and stuff like that if you guys are curious about any of the stuff I've done over the years. See if I can... it was the 80s. I don't remember a lot of it. But I'll make up a good answer anyway, so... So this is, they're not a Nags dealer here, but this is a Nags guitar. This is a signature guitar of mine that I've had out for a while. And they're a company out of Maryland. So if anybody's interested, you can go online and look Nags. They do a lot of different model guitars. But this is a prototype, which has, if anybody knows my Rebel Yell solo, I do a ray gun thing in there, and this we put kind of, built the ray gun into the guitar on this one. Something we tried to do back in the 80s, but didn't quite work out. But this one is actually working, so pretty cool. So. Thank you. Thank you. So yeah, these are just some backing tracks that I've put together that I kind of jam over. One of the things I'm going to show you is the backing track to Rebel Yell minus the guitar track on it. And I'll kind of explain to you how we kind of came up, how we composed the song and how we came up with the guitar parts for that song, which hopefully, how many people here actually play guitar? Yay! So the thing I hope, I always hope to get out of, you know, a clinic or, you know, is to kind of give people an insight into how to, you know, create their own unique style rather than, you know, trying to emulate another guitar player and stuff, because that's really, that was the key to the success with the Billy Idol stuff, was that we kind of, you know, I had all these influences and stuff by the time I met Billy, but how do we make it unique and how do we make Billy Idol music unique to what we were doing? And there's a couple of cool little paths that took me to that, you know, influences that I had. And, you know, now with the internet, it's so cool that people can kind of go and look at some of the stuff that we were listening to at that time and how we ended up with our unique, hopefully unique, approach to what we were doing. I'm going to jump into Rebel Yell now. I'm going to play it for you. As I said, this is a backing track. This is the original recorded backing track, and minus the guitar solo, minus the rhythm guitars, and then I'll explain to you some of the things that are that hopefully make it unique.
Dance.
So obviously back then I didn't have the ray gun guitar. And what we did was, first of all, what's unique about this song is that the guitar part never actually plays the root notes of the chords. And that's something that I always loved about Jimmy Page, even though the Led Zeppelin were essentially three instruments. They always sounded bigger than the sum of the parts because Jimmy Page was such a good arranger and so brilliant at capturing the instruments that a lot of times in previous bands that I had been to before Billy Idol, you come up with some chord changes and the guitar would play the chord changes and the bass would play the same root note as that. And what we realized when we started to work together is that we could make much more out of the sum of the parts than just doing that. So Rebel Yell is really a simple chord structure. It's B minor to A to G to E minor. And so the bass follows along in that structure. So I didn't want to do that. That's, I mean, there's a lot of punk bands doing that, and more power to them. But I figured, you know, we could do something a little bit more unique. So I realized that the top note, based on what Billy's melody was this note. And if the bass went down from B to A, if I kept that note, essentially, I'm playing a D major over the bass going to A. And then when the bass goes to G, if I keep that same note, it creates G major seventh. And the same when it goes to E minor. And so what I loved was this kind of stagnant, and this guitar, it's so silly how simple the guitar part is to Rebel Leo. It's two notes. And then when we get to the chorus, which is the same chords, we don't really change. We weren't smart enough to know how to change. So we just kept going, and I actually play the chords then. But same thing. And that was like the beginning of, you know, kind of the style that became what Billy and I had created uniquely to became an arrangement approach to our music. And it's, you know, it's still, you know, I love when I mean, you ever hear about these musicians who had a hit song in the 80s and they were asked in an interview, oh, you know, how do you feel about playing that song 40 years later or whatever? And they go, oh, you know, there are those bands. I got to tell you, I'm not sick of playing any of these Billy Idol songs. I mean, fortunately, I still work with the guy 37 years later. We're friends, and we have a blast doing it. But there's something timeless about what we tried to create that I think largely has to do with when I picked up the guitar, I played a lot of folk and acoustic guitar. I started playing when I was 7 and a half, and then got an electric guitar when I was 13. So that whole time was spent playing a lot of classical and jazz and, you know, acoustic guitar music. So that played a role in years later with things like Eyes Without a Face, where it was acoustic guitar based. And then when I got an electric guitar, it was like the heyday of the, you know, the early 70s of the English guitar players, obviously Led Zeppelin, but also the progressive rock guys. I loved Steve Howe from Yes and Steve Hackett from Genesis. I'm a real progressive rock nerd. Even though people don't hear it in the Billy Idol thing, the musicality and the sense of arrangement still comes into play. And that's why I tell people and guitar players is it's cool to love the guys that you currently hear that are, you know, tearing up the fretboard and all of this. But it's great to listen to influences outside of guitar. I learned that. I remember I read an interview with Alan Holdsworth, who's like one of the milestones of, I mean, there are these guys who is like Hendrix, Van Halen, Holdsworth, you know, these guys that came along and really changed the face of guitar. And Holdsworth said he never thought of himself as a guitar player. He was trying to emulate John Coltrane. And then it made sense because I never listened to jazz. That was like my dad's shit, you know? And then I listened to it and I went, oh yeah, he's kind of taken a little bit of John Coltrane from, you know, his approach to guitar. And I love that. And even, you know, you look at Tom Morello and he's taken his influences from hip hop. You know, he wanted to learn how to scratch on the guitar and did his whole thing. So I think, you know, that's the one thing. I'm not a guitar teacher. I'm not technically, I couldn't tell you modes and all this kind of stuff. It's not called for in what I do. But I do have a vast interest in music, classical music and film scores, because the arrangement, how I can apply some of those chords and some of those arrangement ideas to what I'm doing on guitar to hopefully have a unique voice on the instrument. And it's always fun to kind of, you know, when I'm jamming with people, to kind of throw something in out of left field. That's, you know, Sammy's a brilliant example of that, because he's perfected the kind of tapping technique in his own way. It's not like the way Van Halen did it, and it's a new approach. And you know, it's and I love seeing that in guitar players who like approach things in a new and different way. So, yeah, I mean, it's just you know, I still have a great love for the instrument. I've been playing it almost my whole life. I still enjoy it. Still the first thing that I do after I have a cup of coffee, coffee's first. Or take out the trash, depending on how much my wife bugs me. See, rock stars still take out the trash. In my house, she's the rock star. Make no bones about it. But then I pick up the guitar and it's always... It's always like full of possibilities, you know, and it's always fun. And I always tell people, you know, I would do this whether I made a living at it or not. I think that's the way it is with most guitar players. We become obsessed with this instrument, buying new gear, and it really, we are in a kind of like a renaissance of guitar players and the guitar gear. There's never been better amplifiers available. You know, I mean, obviously I'm with Dave Friedman and I've known Dave over 24 years now, and we've developed a signature amp together, and I love brainstorming, and he's just another guy, like he's just another kid that went to concerts and like said, I want to do that, you know, and there's a lot of us now. And what's great is when I got my first electric guitar, even though it was, okay, 1974, and we paid like $300 for a piece of crap. I mean, this thing was real. And now, even inflation considered, for what you could spend $300 for on a beginner's guitar is so much better than what we had available. Amps are so much better. Pedals. I mean, we were stuck with a Fuzz Face, a Wah-Wah, and I don't know what else. There wasn't a whole lot, you know. It really wasn't. But now it's like you can trade and you can get used pieces of gear online and stuff. So it really is a great period for guitar playing. I travel the world, and I was just, you know, talking to somebody, and I said, guitar, the state of the guitar is really healthy. You might not hear it as much on the radio. Because that's the way corporate rock radio or corporate music radio is these days. But I can tell you that there's nothing like going to see a real rock and roll band. The guys are sweating and they're playing the solo, and you believe what they're playing is actually happening, rather than, you know, some guy. I mean, I'm using a backing track here, but I couldn't afford to pay musicians to come in today. But that's the great thing about rock and roll, because if you're faking it, fans know, and it's not real, and it's like, eh, you know. I mean, even I, you know, in New York where I grew up, you know, we had the whole kind of like early punk scene and stuff, and a lot of those guys couldn't play very well, But they had the passion about it, and eventually they were going to get better. They were going to become like U2. I saw U2, you know, on the first tour or something. Those guys really couldn't play that well. You know, they were just like kids from Ireland that were like, you know, I don't know what their influences were, but they got better, and their songwriting got better, and they got tighter as a band, and Bono got better as a singer, and that's rock and roll affords you that bands do, you know, over the course of their career. They develop, and I mean, look at the Beatles are the perfect example from what they started as to culminate with, you know, their greatest. Sgt. Pepper is considered one of the greatest. And they're not classically trained, and they have orchestras on their records. So it's more about the idea than the technical or the schooled, you know, well, I'm going to write this. And, you know, it's about, you know, I know Paul McCartney has listened to a lot of classical music, and he said, oh, I'll have a bit of that in my music and stuff. And so really it's, you know, it's I think the state of music and rock and roll and guitar and players is really good right now. So I think it's a healthy time. I'm gonna bring Sammy up. We're gonna do this this track that we worked on. He does all the heavy lifting in this one. So, all right, I'm gonna be Sammy's PR man. He has an instrumental record that you finished it, right? And when's that gonna come out?
March.
All right. So we're all gonna buy Sammy's record. And you got David Bendith to mix it. Is that? So a mutual friend of ours who's like an incredible producer and mixer. Did Sammy's record, so I'm sure, I haven't heard it yet, but I know it's gonna, I've heard the early mixing, but I'm sure it's gonna be incredible. So we spent a day, well, actually only like an hour and a half, we said, we gotta come up with something. And we came up with a little ditty, and it's kind of cool. Thank you. Yeah, not bad for like literally an hour's work of just coming up with stuff. So, I'll take some questions for you guys. You guys got any questions? Somebody? Come on, don't be shy. There we go, gentlemen over there. Okay, what do you got? Sure did. Guilty. Right. Right. That's exactly right. And that was you know, I had one of the mega, there was a guy named Bob Bradshaw in the 80s, and he was the only guy who would put together rigs. So he did Steve Lukather and myself and a bunch of other guitar players. But there wasn't a lot of, it always seemed like you sacrificed your pure guitar tone back then for having the ability to switch effects and all this kind of stuff. And when I moved to Los Angeles about 25 years ago, I brought with me from New York, where I was living, my big Bradshaw system and everything. And it was in kind of bad shape. So I somehow, through word of mouth, I met Dave. And that was verbatim what you were saying. He said, wouldn't it be great to get back to, you know, have the ability to do all the effects and everything, but still have the pure guitar sound, not sacrifice that in the name of flexibility. And
that's what I did, I guess.
That's your mantra. I mean, that's the thing. And it's so crazy because I still have, you know, my old Plexi amps and stuff and all of that. And it's, you know, it's really not that much different. I mean, your amps are obviously much more flexible, much more durable, and I can travel the world with them, whereas those other things were always breaking down. But essentially, I think the sound that Dave grew up with in his ear is the same sound that I always wanted to emulate, and whether it was Hendrix or Zeppelin or AC/DC, it's that English-based thing that, you know, obviously you stretch the envelope of it, but...
Yeah, quite a bit.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. I'm not going to go there, I don't think so, yeah. But sometimes it's tempting to just, you know, plug it in the bar, and, you know, what's your take on that as well?
There's some people that have, I think stylistically has a lot to do with it. If you didn't grow up with, you know, as I said, Led Zeppelin and, you know, Deep Purple and that as your, in your DNA, if you didn't grow up with that, a Kemper is great. You know, and I've been on tour with bands who, you know, I've seen them use Kempers and stuff, and it works for them. See, like Def Leppard, Kempers work great for them because they've always had a very processed guitar sound, and there's two guitar players, and they're very intertwined parts, and it makes total sense why they would use Kempers. For me, with Billy Idol, it's just not the thing. I own one, and I use it at home. Because when I'm recording a demo of a song, I want to get the idea down really quickly. So, and singers are very impatient people. You think guitar players are impatient? Singers are the worst because they want to catch inspiration. It's not like we kind of go, what about a G chord? I don't know. Let's have a coffee and think about it. Singers are like, I want to write about this, you know. And I get that. It's all about catching a fire. And a Kemper is a great little tool or Axe FX or any of those things to get a very basic approximation of what you think it's going to sound like. But that, to me, that's where the demo ends and the real record begins with, you know. And I will say the producers that I work with, you know, they don't use Kempers. It's just not. For those kind of records, it's not. You know, there's no air in it. And
use the real thing.
Yeah.
It's, you know, it feels better.
What about the
Well, the cool thing about this is the newest version of, is this an SS?
Yeah, this is a new updated SS100. So now it has sort of some of the features that a B Deluxe has. It has a separate gain and master for the lead channel now, where it didn't before. And then it has all the same sounds, but it's updated sounds too. So
yeah, so with this kind of update, I don't need to. Ordinarily, I would have to, and it's still when I'm recording for a solo, I want to kick in a gain boost thing. I don't leave it on all the time. I try and get the best guitar sound I can with clarity, you know, have sustain as opposed to distortion. And I guess I got my ass kicked by a lot of record producers who don't like very super distorted sounds on records because it eats up a lot of frequencies, makes things harder to, you know, they want definition and, I mean, think about, you know, I hate to keep going back to Led Zeppelin, but how clean those guitars are. Now, if the guitars weren't that clean, the drums wouldn't appear as heavy as they are. John Bonham's drums, compared to what sonically is happening now, is not taking up as much, but because the guitar is kind of a little bit small and squashy, the drums appear that much different. So I don't record with distortion pedals, but I will use them for a solo or something. But this amp, I don't need to because my boost pedal is part of the amp. So, okay, yeah, sir. Say that again?
Why not make a pedal?
A pedal. Well, because I can't get to it. I mean, I guess you could do the rate or something. This particular circuit, Dave built the circuit, and it was the only one I found, and the company no longer makes it anymore. So I couldn't think, how do you
put it? It's a Friedman-powered ray gun.
It is a Friedman-powered ray gun. Yeah, it was a toy ray gun circuit. Yeah, I think there's something. It's kind of cool. I don't know. It's kind of cool that it's kind of under my fingers here. And, you know, obviously there's the rate, but also there's a frequency thing. So I kicks ass, man. It's like, so I would have to have three.
So much for the speakers.
Sorry about that. I can control. There's a trim pot in there, and I maxed it. So, but yeah. So I'm working on three different rate, frequency, and all that. So I'd have to have three different pedals to do that, and it seemed easier to just to put it on the guitar. So, yeah.
So. Yeah, I've followed you.
He never did an amp for me.
No, that guy.
No, he never did. He did Billy Duffy. This is how the story. Okay, there was a friend of mine who was from Hong Kong, named Henry Yee, right? And he was this madman. Used to work at a speaker shop, but he would mod my amps for me, and we didn't really do much. He would just change the tube holders to ceramic so they wouldn't arc. He would just make the amps, you know, reliable. We didn't really do much to them. And then I met Billy Duffy because the Cult opened for Billy Idol in 1987. And
I was there.
Were you there?
Well, at least out here.
So I knew Harry Colby was in New York. He was an amp guy. And I didn't want to share my guy. So I said to Billy Duffy, he said, well, your amps sound really good. Who did them? So I said, Harry Colby. So Billy Duffy brought his amps to Harry Colby. and that's how the story. And so Harry Colby has said that I brought an amp to him. I don't know. I don't ever remember this. I mean, the 80s, like I said, you know, maybe.
Is,
yeah.
Anytime there's no bullshit that I've had it.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, everybody that picks up a guitar is going to sound uniquely different. But also, it's you know, it's what you hear in your head and what you're emulating, and And obviously, you know, when I was recording certain things, you know, I'm hearing this guitar sound. And sometimes I'd even bring a CD in, you know. A good example is Billy Idol's producer, Keith Forsey, was not a rock and roll guy. He came from doing Donna Summer's records, actually. And so I would have to explain to him about what I was hearing. The middle bit in Eyes Without a Face, this... Right? So I'm trying to, I'm hearing it in my head and I'm going, Keith, no, it's got to sound, I said to him, like the rhythm guitar and Beat It. That's basically was the closest kind of thing that we, it's nothing like that, but it's the way that it impressed. And so a lot of times I'm just like, you know, hearing it in my head and trying to replicate it, and as best as I can. I don't always nail it, but I try. You know, and that's the thing with guitar players. I think we'll always be like, it's not good enough. It's still, you know, we're always never satisfied, really. But that's what's great about it, because you can always get better. You can always come up with a cooler riff. You can always get a better guitar sound and write a better song. Yeah. It was a great experience. It was the first like session that I had done, high profile session that I had done outside of Billy Idol. And I was expecting, I heard all the same things about Michael Jackson and crazy stuff, and I expected this huge entourage. And so I get to the studio, and when I recorded with Idol, it was always myself, Billy, our engineer, our producer, and an engineer. No hangers on or anything. And I open up the door. We're at Westlake Studios, and who greets me but Quincy Jones, the producer? There's Michael and an engineer, and that was it. And I was like, it was totally the same. I was so comfortable because it was the same way of working as I was used to. And Michael was really chill, man. I mean, he just said, you know, kind of. This was the melody. I worked on Dirty Diana, so they had the melody idea, and it wasn't like he put music in front of me. He just said, ba-da-da-da-da-da, and he kind of hummed it and scattered it, showed me where there's a very unique little hiccup like that I didn't get it the first time. It's like a little pause in the guitar phrase the second time through, and he was really like, no, gotta get this. His really attention to detail was great, but what was really cool is, so the whole session was only about 2 hours. We did the thing, and then we did the video, and the video, that's where the stories get deep. Shit gets real at the video. Bubbles the Chimp was at the video. Had his own van. Seriously, swings, Jungle Jim. He wore Elizabeth Taylor's Passion perfume. I don't know what that was about. But it was cool. But that was a whole day on the set with Michael, and he was getting ready to do his big rock tour. And none of the R&B artists ever had big rock tours. So he's asking me about Motley Crue. He had seen Queen. He'd seen these productions. And by then, we had done one big arena tour with Idol. So I suggested a lighting company, a sound company, and this and that. And he goes, oh, do you know Motley Crue? I didn't know Motley Crue. No, I don't know Motley Crue. He goes, well, you know Eddie, right? I go, yeah, he's on that Beat It song with you. I think everybody knows that guy. He goes, yeah, I saw Van Halen. And he proceeded to do a spot on, if you can imagine this, Michael Jackson imitating David Lee Roth. I will go to my grave having seen that. Nobody else has probably seen it. It was amazing. It was awesome. But I had a blast working with him. He was really, really, really one of those, you know, pinch me moments, like, wow. And I never knew, like, Billy Idol was really popular on MTV, right? Those videos were shown a lot. Now, that's one level. But then the Michael Jackson video. But I was never really, I lived in New York, and people don't really bother you in New York. This is before paparazzi and all this stuff. And so the Michael Jackson video premiered on E! Entertainment, on NBC. It was like a world event, you know? And I didn't really keep aware of that. But the next day, I walked down West Broadway, and I passed by a McDonald's, and people streamed out. Hey, you're in the Michael Jackson video. I had to sign. It was the first time I had to, like, form a line to sign autographs. And I went, oh, yeah, it's Michael Jackson. I didn't like it. I was uncomfortable with that. I like my anonymity, you know. I work with a lot of high-profile people, and it's a 24/7 job. And I really, you know, that I always tell this story. When I was a kid, 1968 was the Elvis comeback special, and we watched. I watched it with my parents, and of course, and there was only one color TV between my cousins and my parents. So we watched it, and there's Elvis, and there's my mom and my aunt. And they're all like, oh, he's so beautiful. Look at Elvis. Da, da, da. And me and my dad are like, yeah, that guitar player, that guy's shit hot. And I was like, that's what I wanted to be. I wanted to be the guy that got to hang with Elvis and make music. I didn't want that attention thing. And I guess that's, you know, I mean, that us guitar players, we kind of fit in that mold, the kind of slightly behind, still get to be creative, but don't have all the other stuff, the other, you know. All my guitar heroes are quite kind of reserved guys, you know. I mean, that's been the guitar thing, you know. Any other questions? Yeah.
I can hear some of your progressive influences in that last song you did with Sammy, the Mellow Start.
Sure. Yeah. All right. So these, I did two records with the drummer Terry Bozzio and Tony Levin. And they were totally improvised in the studio. And fortunately, there was at that time there was a record label, Magna Carta, that kind of put you in the studio. And they gave us a nice studio and a nice budget. And they were just happy to have these artists on the label, knowing that this was not going to be a million seller. You know, it was kind of like a niche thing. And I was just surprised. The project started with Terry, who's an incredible drummer, and they presented all these. They said, Terry, we got this idea to this improvised thing in the studio. Who would you want as a guitar player? And they put out their list of names. This is the story Terry told me, and there was the usual cast of characters, the great guitar players of early 90s. And Terry said, no, Steve Stevens would be my first choice. And they kind of went, okay. I think because we both, you know, Terry with Zappa, but also understanding about, you know, how to make something commercially listenable with Missing Persons. And so we had a kind of mutual approach to music and stuff. And I think he felt he needed a guitar player that was a little bit more grounded rather than all over the place to allow him to do his kind of very finesse drum thing. And so I went out. He was living in Austin, Texas. I went out and spent some time with him, and then we said, okay, who do we get on bass? And I said, we'll never be able to get this guy, but if we could, Tony Levin would be pretty cool. And lo and behold, we found a time slot where Tony was in King Crimson and Peter Gabriel, and I'd seen him in all these. And Tony was, I don't think those records could have worked without Tony, because he really held down the fort. He's a very, like, even keel guy, but also his approach was like, he'll just play one big note when me and Terry go crazy, and he really allowed us the room to do that. But I haven't talked to those guys. I saw Terry. He moved to Japan. He lives in Japan, and I saw him maybe about a year ago. And we said, yeah, you know, at some point when we're all available to do something, it would be great. Because no, with the same, we'd have to do it with the same guys. The same. Possibly. I mean, my reference of progressive, I mean, people talk about, like, Dream Theater as being progressive, and that's for a different generation. For me, progressive is Genesis with Peter Gabriel and close to the, you know, that's my wheelhouse and stuff. So this little, you know, I work with a band called Deadland Ritual, which is Geezer Butler on bass and Matt Sorum on drums, and a singer named Frankie Perez. And I'm always throwing in little progressive, little hooks and things like that. We haven't recorded our album yet, but I can tell you that there's a lot of little progressive essences in that, because so much so. Yeah, I've talked to Geezer about that. I mean, they were blues-based, but it was the time when King Crimson had just come out with their first record. So I love that era of music. It's really like, those records still sound great to me. You know, they really do. Anyone else? Yeah.
Highlights. The best highlight is that 38 years later, I still work with the guy. That's pretty amazing in my business. And, you know, there are bands that are out there and they tour and you go see them and the singer arrives in a separate plane to the guitar player because they hate each other and they're at the separate ends of the arena or whatever and don't let them meet, you know. And we travel together, we go out, we have dinner together, I think maybe one of he is the boss, right? And the buck stops with him. I mean, I'm always allowed my freedom, and I contribute in the songwriting. But in the end, it's his decision. And I think that makes things a little bit clearer. In bands, there's always, even, you know, Led Zeppelin was Jimmy Page's band. You know, those are, on the first two records, people don't realize the other guys other than Jimmy Page were paid a salary. You know, it was, and I think bands need that. You need one person. It's like at a household. If everybody's doing the same thing and everybody's kind of, you know, I'm going to cook, and you know, it's like you got to have one person who's going to make the decisions, either musically or stylistically or what. And that's, but you got to respect the person you're working with, because if you don't, you're going to be, I don't get the chance to do what I want to do. Or, you know, during a Billy Idol show, I'm going to play a little nylon string guitar, but I get to do a guitar solo that's as long as I want to do it. He's always like, make it longer. I'm like, yeah, you know, they're waiting for Cradle of Love. I know it. They want Dancing with Myself. Let's not fool ourselves. But it's great that he gives me that freedom to do stuff. And I'm the musical director, so I get to like shape the production and the band and work with the musicians. It's not, you know, he's a singer and he doesn't want to go in there and blow his voice out for 5 days, where by the time the tour starts, he's you know, been killing himself. So I get the band ready, and we have a really good understanding and a mutual respect. And he's always like, I mean, he's you know, very complimentary, and I think that, you know, you just mellow out with age, and you kind of appreciate what you do have, you know. And I see these bands that are such great musicians, and they had such great chemistry, and you like, oh, wouldn't it be great if they could get along and tour, and we get to see them? So I think it means a lot for Billy Idol fans that they come see us, and we're still the two same old bastards up there doing it. You know, it's kind of cool. You know, people have like great stories about getting thrown out of their house because they played Rebel Yell too loud, and their parents, you know. It's great to hear all that kind of stuff. And so as I mentioned, during the one of the things I always kind of like love doing is the acoustic side of my playing. So I'm going to play a little bit of nylon string guitar for you. And like I said, during the way that I had started on that instrument, but the way that my solo developed, it was I was with Vince Neil and we were touring behind, we were opening for Van Halen. And Vince said, you got to do a guitar solo. And I'm like, yeah, but you know, in about an hour, Eddie's going to come out and do Eruption. And you know, come on. It's a Ferrari right there, you know. It's the pinnacle of electric guitar solo. So I developed an acoustic guitar solo. I said, this is uniquely my thing. And it kind of stuck. And it's always been a part of what I do, largely because of Steve Howe. I learned on that Fragile record was Mood for a Day, and I loved all that style of stuff. So it's been, you know, I've been doing it since the Vince Neil days, and I still do that soul, you know, the kind of meat and potatoes of it, the skeleton of it. It's virtually the same that I do with Billy Idol now.
So this is a Godin nylon string guitar. That's it's not mine. It's actually the store's instrument. And this is Godin has been my longest standing guitar endorsement. I've been with them 25 years, and they make a lot of different models. If you're interested, go online. So the funny thing is, to this day, so I went to the High School Performing Arts, the school that they made the Fame movie about, and the reason, and you had to take an audition, and what I played for my audition was. That probably 25, 26 years. But it's one of those pieces that's Mood for a Day by Steve Howe from Yes. And those things stay with you. It's interesting that a lot of the music that we grew up with that as adolescents and that you share with people and stuff stays with you. It has a lot of like emotional stuff attached. But I think that the thing about making records, the best, absolute best thing about making records and playing for people is to hopefully give them that feeling. When I was a kid and I went to see Yes in 1974, and it was like the moon landing. It was such a huge thing for me. And then saw The Who and saw the Prince on the before Purple Rain and all that, and see these artists that you knew, this person is going to be a huge star. And hopefully, that's the thing that I tap into to try and get, remind myself of how I felt when I was 13, 14 years old, playing guitar, and give that feeling back to people. Because there's the musicians that I work with that are humble and grateful and good people, and you want to be around there, they have exactly that. There's a lot of people that not a lot, but there's other musicians that they're just out there because it's a mortgage payment or this and that, and they don't really, they're just, I don't know, the guitar players that I know in other bands and stuff, we still get together and we geek out over the same stuff. Hey, you remember hearing that first Bowie record with Mick Ronson on, and then you'll try and, I did an all-star tour in South America with Gene Simmons. And of course, you know, everybody's expecting the Gene Simmons that they see on TV. And we're thinking, we're already planning, okay, we're gonna have to let him have the sound check first because he ain't gonna wanna sit around and he ain't gonna, well, he couldn't have been more gracious. Wanted to wait till the end of the sound check because he wanted to watch everybody else do their sound check. And then he constantly had his iPhone and he was playing obscure rock tracks from glam rock bands and you had to like name the tune. Like, you know, hey, what's this? And you put it on and go, oh, it's Jabriath. It's the first record from the, you know, he's still a record geek when you come down to it. Yeah, he's a mega mogul, you know, executive who's been very successful in that. But we still, when it comes down to the music stuff, we still geek out over the same stuff. So, all right, any other questions? Yes. Eyes Without a Face. I can name that without a problem. Because it's got everything in it, right? All right, so the song came up with, that's one of the ones that I came in with the music for. And I was living in the basement of my parents' house and they had a little crappy little radio and the only station that I could get in clearly was an oldie station, CBS FM. And they played, there was some like Frankie Valli thing or something. And it was one of those doo-wop. So I'm like listening to us. But something about it, I went, wow, I wonder if Billy Idol could sing a thing like that. Like, because he's a bit of a crooner, loves Elvis. And I said, yeah, but you can't just do it. So I substituted the chords and I put major sevenths and minor sevenths and slowed it down. And it was like, I remember when we did it, we were really nervous because he had never done anything like that. But then we recorded the most of the song and then we said, we can't just have this mellow thing. We got to have some guitar thing in the middle, some rock explosion thing. And that's how we just built the track up. And then, you know, it's like building a house. You get the, you know, the skeleton of it and then keep adding stuff. And it was really special. That record was, it's almost like it was like somebody would have had to mess up really bad for it not to be successful. Because we really spent a lot of time on it. The inspiration was there. We had already done one record together and toured. So we kind of knew, you know, we were like a well-oiled machine by then. Next, anybody else? Yeah.
How many guitars you got now and what are your three favorites?
What's that?
Yeah. How many guitars you have now and what are your three favorites?
I have a Charvel. Now I was a Hamer player back in the days. I had my own signature guitar, and then Grover Jackson shows up to a Billy Idol show and gives me a Charvel. It was a glow in the dark. I still have the guitar, and to look at the guitar, you wouldn't. I mean, it's one of the iconic 80s Charvels, but I recorded Top Gun, which I won a Grammy for on that. I did the Michael Jackson with that. I did the Vince Neil record with that. Atomic Playboys with that. So that guitar, it just always sounded good, you know? And I had other companies kind of chasing to try and copy it, and they never could. Washburn came very close. There's a Steve Stevens Washburn guitar that's pretty damn close. But that guitar has been like a real good luck charm. And then with my first, in the middle of, well, I'm getting back to Steve Howe again, but in the middle of the Fragile record came with a booklet. There's a picture of Steve Howe and he's playing this classical guitar and it's got wood pegs. I learned it was a flamenco instrument and there's a Ramirez. So when I got my first royalty check, I went to Chicago. Somebody found where these Ramirezes were and we went to a warehouse. And they were just in boxes. They were in bad shape, a lot of them. But I found one good one, and I still have that guitar. It means a lot. And it was one of those, if ever I own a guitar, I want that one, you know. Again, it's a connection to to something that you, you know, as a kid maybe, I was like, oh, one day I'm going to have that guitar. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
Would you consider a guitar from Dave?
What's that?
Would you consider a guitar from Dave?
I have one of Dave's guitars. I toured all over Europe with it. And it uses, you know, it's a Grover Jackson guitar.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So it's, yeah. Absolutely. I mean, you know, it's the thing I always tell guitar manufacturers, I'm free to play whatever I want to play. I have a Nag signature guitar, but they understand I'm going to. And Dave's guitar is so different than what Nags do. So, yeah. So it's, and I love that guitar. It's cool.
Yeah, you did the whole solo tour pretty much.
I did a solo tour with that guitar, and it sounded awesome. Next. Anybody? Yes, sir.
Could you just talk for just a second about, you mentioned that, you know, right after the cup of coffee, it's guitar time.
Yeah.
What, you know, all these years later as a professional musician, like, what, do you have some daily routines, some, you know, things that you do as a player to keep your chops up and, you know, or is it always just there, or is it
no,
just
it's,
when you're gigging, or, you know?
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely, it depends. At certain times of the year, okay, right now I'm in writing mode. I'm supposed to come up with songs with Billy Idol for new recordings. So the thing I want accomplished is hopefully have a new song to present them. So, you know, when I have the guitar in my hands, I'm always thinking right now of an idea for a song. You know, what can I, oh, maybe this will be good. And I always put them on my little iPhone and just always just capture the ideas, you know, in their most basic form. But then before we, okay, after, if we're not in recording mode, then we're in preparing for a tour or something. So we usually do about 4 or 5 days of rehearsal where I have the guitar in my hands the whole day and my chops get really good at that point. If I go on, if my wife and I manage to get a vacation or something, I don't bring a guitar with me because I want to break from it, you know, because I do. My wife handles my business and stuff, and it can get a bit, you know. It's nice to have, if we're all right, we're going to go away, and there's going to be no guitar, no business. We're going to shut off the phone. And so I try and take little breaks from it. And I find sometimes you get good perspective. You go, oh, I never would have thought of that had I not been away from the instrument. So, yeah. Yeah.
Besides Billy Idol, what other project have you
done along? Wow, I mean, I've never even, okay. So this was a really valuable lesson. I tell this to people starting out, musicians. So before I was with Billy Idol, I was with a band that got signed to Island Records, and we were living in Manhattan. There was a music building there. There was 10 floors, and Cyndi Lauper lived there, and a bunch of musicians, a lot of punk bands, and this. And we got a record deal signed to Island Records, and our producer was the Jimmy Miller, legendary producer who did the Rolling Stones classic records. And we went down, and at that time, Island Records had a studio in the Bahamas. And we were poor, as you know. I mean, this is like not even ramen noodle time. This is like we were like Spam, you know, between three of us, a can of Spam. But we looked good. We were skinny. But so we thought, wow, we've made it. We're all, you know, we go down to the Bahamas, and anyway, here's the insult to injury. The last record, when we got to the studio, we got in at night and we meet the engineer, one of the engineers, and goes, hey man, what have you guys been up to down here in the studio? Back in Black, right? So they play us, before it had been released or mixed, play us like two tracks, and we go, we're going to sound incredible. we're going to be like that. Well, tough luck. The project ended up not working out. There was a lot of problems involved, and the band split up. I ended up leaving the band, but just at the end of leaving, and I was heartbroken. I had put everything into this and really thought this was my shot. And so the band breaks up. I end up meeting, just at the end of the band, Bill Acoin, who's the manager of Kiss, and I'm going to put together a band. He had seen this band, and we all agreed that, it's probably not going to happen for us. I like the guys and everything, but none of us really understood about writing songs, and we didn't have an identity. We were like a little bit of this, a little bit of that. We couldn't really pin it down. So I meet Billicoin. They start to manage me. A month later, I get a call from him, and he says, "You ever heard of Billy Idol? He's moved to New York. We manage him." So had that record worked out and not been a failure, I would have never been in Billy Idol. And the stuff that I learned what not to do on that record, I took with me and said, well, I'm not going to make that mistake again. I didn't know how to mic up a guitar amplifier very well. And I took it upon myself, and the engineer was not the guy to do it. So I kind of like took it upon myself to meet people who knew how to record guitars. And every situation like that has been, you know, the first Billy Idol record wasn't Rebel Yell. It had White Wedding on it, but that was largely a song that Billy wrote at the end of the record. And that's what gave us, that was like the last thing we recorded on the first record, White Wedding. And we go, that's the blueprint. Now the next record, that's the starting point, has to be on that level. And maybe if we came out with a blockbuster record the first time through, who knows what would have happened. So everything that didn't work out, you always learn from. And the mistakes, there are no real mistakes, you know. It's like, I'm sure you didn't build the ultimate amp the first time you tried.
Heck no. No way.
Probably got shocked a couple of times.
Still do. Yeah,
right. So, yeah, I mean, that's, you know, that's all part of it. You know, it's all part of, you know, nobody that I know has ever gotten it right the first time. So. Anybody else? Yes. Say that again? A Boss compressor. That's right, yeah. usually I would use a little Boss EQ pedal. For that track, for some reason, the EQ pedal wasn't doing it. So I just wanted sustain, but not more distortion. And I used the compressor on that. That's exactly right, yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And to me, it's very progressive, as in what I would define being progressive, where you're blending bluesy, classical style stuff, the Spanish guitar stuff.
Right.
It's ironic that you did say that you kind of pulled that to Billy Idol, because to me, that's where it came from.
Right.
I figured that was the start of it. But to me, my question to you is that you as more of yourself than even with the Billy Idol stuff? Because I've heard your stuff from the beginning of the Bible, and then I've heard some of your other stuff, and I'm looking forward to the new Deadlands.
Right, yeah.
For me, it just seems like there's more progressive roots for you in that album, and you actually, instead of just laying back and being tasteful with Idol, you let it rip a little bit more on that album.
Right. With Billy Idol, it's all about being economic and making, it's obviously it's the song, it's his vocal performance that has to be great. Everything has to support that. Because they're rock records, but they're rock pop records, and that presents its own set of challenges. And sometimes the guitar is not the main instrument. Or I remember we had a big, when we did the follow up to Rebel Yell, was To Be a Lover, and there's hardly any guitar on that. And I was like, wow. And I ended up playing keyboards on that, and I was like, wow. But I looked at it. At first, I'm like, wow, this is... But then it was a challenge. Can I play keyboards on this thing? So here I am. I go to do the Vince Neil record, and it's the complete opposite. So I'm working... I'm in the studio with him, and the producer is Ron Everson, and we're tracking a song, and we got like an eight... Usually a Billy Idol solo is 8 bars, right? So we've got 8 bars. And Vince goes, make the guitar longer. Guitar solo's got to be longer. Yeah. All right, we make it 16 bars. Well, the first song on the record has I think it's 36-bar guitar solo.
The edge is pretty long.
Right? Look in Your Eyes, I'm thinking of, right? Right. It's a long guitar solo. And I'm like, I'm running out of steam. I'm like, you know, all right, can you guys punch me in? I'm not used to doing this kind of thing. It was totally the opposite thing, which was a whole different challenge. And also to be, you know, everything is down-tuned on that record, whole step. So it was all, it was a chance for me to get heavy, you know. And that's what, you know, I like all aspects of it. You know, all aspects of making music is and there's different challenges presented in different things.
Yeah, and I think with that, it had to be pretty freeing because basically we use a lot of the wah. There's a lot of stuff that
right.
you don't typically get in idle. And I think one of the things I like about your playing is the versatility.
Thank you.
Like even from like the first Billy Idol album.
Right.
You were doing things with effects that other guys weren't doing aside from Eddie. So
right.
And you did it differently than what he did. I mean, there was, but the playing was still more subdued other than, you know, I mean, nice use of chords.
Right.
The layering is good, but all song oriented.
Right.
And I think, but then you really showed a lot more technique and what you're able to do aside from that style of music.
With absolutely.
Stuff. And I absolutely, you know, adore that album. I mean, to be honest, I mean, no one's going to confuse Mick Mars for you, so. Not to throw any hate on him, but the reality is that's the best stuff.
What we tried to do was make the record we thought should have come after Dr. Feelgood. So that was kind of, because I loved that record. And I thought, well, what would I want to hear Vince Neil do after that? You know, we didn't have Bob Rock as a producer. We didn't have that massive drum sound and Bob's a genius at, you know, his records are just sonically like superior. But song wise and everything, I was like, well, what if I was going to hear it, you know, I try and put myself in the perspective of the fan. All right. You know, say I'm a fan of Motley Crue, man, it's a bummer Vince is leaving, but what would I want if he was going to leave, what would I want him to sound like? Well, I hope it sounds a bit like Dr. Feelgood or something. So that's what we strive for at least. Right.
Vince's voice was really good, but I thought just the two of you made it. It was a really nice blend, and then mixing up. I mean, you really played more Guitar Hero guitar on that.
Right. Album, yeah. Yeah.
You know what I mean? So, you know, that's not really what Motley Crue is known for. So.
Okay, I got you.
That's what I mean. So that. Right. Kind of like, you know, taking Stephen Vai and going.
Right.
Let's throw him in with Vince Neil. That's kind of.
Yeah, thanks. It was a fun record to do. It was, you know, it was because I'm a kid from New York, so here I am in the amongst the California thing. It was crazy, man. It was like it's a whole different breed out here. Yeah. Next, yeah.
Sorry about my English. I'll try to explain.
Yeah.
What sort of stories?
you can share about how you came with the idea to the company, and I don't know.
Well, you know, I started out, moved to, you know, Southern California when I was 18 years old from Detroit. And I started working for a company at the time called Andy Brower Studio Rentals. And they were a studio instrument rental and cartage company that was carting famous guitar players around, like session guitar players like Steve Lukather and Michael Landau and Dan Huff and Tim Pierce and all these amazing players. So I started working in the industry. Well, I'm going to fast forward this a little bit. There was a guy that was doing some guitar racks for people there, and he left the company. And I had been watching him and interested because my whole life it was the guy that took things apart. I mean, I think you'd like to tinker too, you know. I mean, just like
I couldn't put it back together.
Yeah, well, yeah, take everything apart and build it back up and better, you know. And so I'm like, I can do this. So I started, you know, working in the industry building guitar systems for many famous guitar players. I mean, over the years, a huge repertoire of people, you know. Steve and Jerry Cantrell and Eddie Van Halen. And I've actually forgotten more than I can remember off the top of my head. And the one story that stands out that was probably my favorite is, so I, I was a growing up, I was a huge Eddie Van Halen fan. So I eventually done work and done rigs for him. So I eventually get his original Marshall that he recorded every record with, right? And so they had this idea, they wanted it restored. And restored, well, it had been rewired at different times with the different kinds of wire and stuff. So what I wound up doing is putting it back to what I thought it was originally from all accounts and everything else. And we actually wound up robbing vintage wire out of another same era Marshall and rewiring the whole amp. So when I'm done, he takes it, you know, when I'm done, he takes it and tries it. And he goes, that's the best it sounded in 30 years or 20 years or whatever he said. And then I'm like, what is there more? You know, it, but coming from someone that was, you know, a kid at one time where going to see him.
Yeah.
And then you now worked for most of your idols or something during the time, you know, your heroes. They're just normal people.
Did you plan on having an amplifier line? Like, was that like, one day I would love to have an amp line?
Well, I started off really early an amp line with, when I first got involved with it and really started learning was the very early 90s with Bruce Eggnetter.
Right.
And we made the IE4 preamp. Right. And I think I showed it to you when you were rehearsing with Vince Neil and Dave Marshall wanted to use it, but it didn't happen. I don't remember what the deal was with
right.
that.
Right.
But, that's where I started learning all my chops was from Bruce. So he was the sort of the mentor to me. So that's where it started, you know, but I'm obsessed with the amp sounds, you know? So
yeah,
yeah sure. Eventually it formed into a company. I wanted to make my own amp and yeah, but I haven't played seriously for a long time. So, you know, now it's mostly just testing and stuff.
I was saying to Dave, when I was in Europe during these festivals with the all-star band, Deadland Ritual, and it'd be like, I mean, literally 50 bands on the bill, and you're backstage, and it was just Friedmans and Friedmans and Friedmans. Like, it made me very proud. I should have photographed it, like,
you were one of the very first.
I still have the first. I still have the first
guy
you worked on.
Yeah.
I still have that.
Yeah. I think you were the first guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Anyone else?
I have a question.
Sure.
So making the heads and stuff, do you also design the cabinets like the woods and the speakers? And so what's the formula behind a 212, 412, or pairing with heads and all that stuff?
Well, I mean, the 412s came from sort of vintage 412s that I liked. 212s, I set out to design a 212 that sounds pretty damn good, small package, cut down. We experimented with a bunch of stuff. There's a little port in the back of the 212s, tiny port that just lets a little air out, a little less boxy. It's more trial and error than it is math on these. And also choosing the speakers that goes in it. I personally like vintage 30s in our 212 cabinet, for instance, better than other choices in that 212 cabinet. To some reason, it works in the 212. Works really well. But, you know, we use Greenback 25-watt Celestians. We also use vintage 30s. Depends on what the cabinet is.
What would you use if it had all the percussiveness of the Ray
Well, seen. I think they still work. Well, it's kind of interesting. So when I first started working with Steve, he was a vintage 30 guy. And he would only use vintage 30s. He tried to switch back to 25s, which he originally liked a few times. But it was like, no, I need the percussiveness of the vintage 30s. Then it went to two greenbacks and two vintage 30s. And then it went to all greenbacks again. And now he's back to the original kind of speakers he used back in the old days.
Which means, basically, I have no idea.
So, the interesting thing also is, I remember saying to him one time, I mean, your sound was that quintessential Plexi Marshall thing. That was your thing. And now you're using these 5150 amps, and they don't sound anything like that, you know? That's right. And it's not that they didn't sound good. They sounded good. But I'm like, it seems to me like this is how we got started. Yeah. It seems to me like you should have the tone that you were known for.
Right.
Sort of. And that's how we got cooking
and
on amps.
And a lot of time is the relationship between, you know, I'm still miking up a cabinet when I play live. So it's the relationship, what kind of microphone are you using? And Dave's amps have a lot more bottom end than the amps like my Plexi Marshalls. Like, they have nowhere near the bottom end that Dave's amps have. So the speaker, sometimes I like the fact that the, because the vintage 30s have a very resonant peak, like a
High mid peak,
yeah. Which if you like it, great, but it's hard to get rid of that. And I find with the other speakers, I can hear more of the character of the microphone. So if I want to swap out a different microphone, either a ribbon mic or something else, I can really tailor the sound a little bit more without starting with something I can't get rid of. Anyone else? Yeah.
Very different. It's an entirely different circuit. There was for a while. Will it come back ever? I mean, we can do it on custom shop special order. I haven't done very many that way, but I've done a few. I think you tried that one a long time ago. I think that was the first amp I brought you to try.
Maybe.
Yeah, weird knobs, big knobs.
I think so.
Was that in Venice when you were rehearsing at McGrath's?
Yeah, because is that the amp that very similar to the one that was on Perfect Circle?
Yes, that was that.
I remember that because I heard the record and I called you and I said, because I knew that Billy had used your amp.
Yeah.
And what's that? That thing sounds great. Bring me one. Anyone else? So, I think I'll sign stuff for you guys, you know, spend a little time over there.
Now we got a raffle to do.
Oh, okay, cool.
Come on, John. Do the raffle.
What are you raffling?
The BEOD Deluxe pedal, two-channel pedal.
Cool. Ben's got you guys want to do this since you're up here? It's too much pressure for me. Okay, that's responsibility.
Do you shake it up? Come on.
Shake it
good.
Shake it really good. So yeah, guys, we got this. Do you want to talk about that BEOD Deluxe a little bit?
It's a pedal.
It's a pedal. What's
it sound like? Two channels. It's actually designed to simulate, you know, this a lot of sounds in my amps. It's not one particular amp, but it does that into almost any clean amp. I mean, it does a pretty damn good job of it too. Lots of gain. If you're scared of gain, don't buy it. If you want gain, buy it. All right. So, just ending numbers?
Well, let's just do all.
Okay. 1, 2, 1, 2, 7, 4.
12, 12, 74.
Woo!
Yeah! Wait, it's back there behind you. Does someone you know play guitar? Well, there you go. Congratulations, you win.
You're going to get a lot of housework out of that pedal.
Yeah, now she doesn't have to get you a Christmas gift, right?
That's awesome.
I got a question. Why does Sammy use a bass compressor?
Actually, that's a really good guitar compressor.
Is it?
Have you ever tried it?
See, these are the...
This is a little hot tip there.
This is stuff that you learn. Like, I would have never thought to use a bass compressor.
It's the MXR bass compressor. They're very cool for guitar.
Where's Sammy? Why do you like that?
That's what I tossed on it.
Oh, that's yours.
I made him this pedal board for do this stuff.
To do the clinics. Okay.
But I knew that was a great pedal, and I had it laying around, and we put it on his board.
Okay.
It's really, I venture to say, it's sort of 1176 like.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it's
pretty cool.
Yeah.
You should try it sometime. You always love to experiment with compressors.
Totally. Yeah, that's cool. I have a question on the original Plexi Marshall. What was the difference between the bass amp and the guitar?
The super bass and the guitar. The super lead and the super bass original Marshall. Right. So essentially, it was a difference in the front end of it in the preamp section mostly. And the super lead, they made one channel have a lot less bass with more of a mid-range focus. Right. So the bright channel on what you typically would get.
Left side.
Yes, left side, sorry. Okay. Uh-huh. You know, it's bright, it's right. cutting, it right. doesn't have a lot of bass in it.
Right.
The other side is pretty dark and bassy.
Right.
But on a super bass, there's it's kind of like a cross between the two on channel one.
Okay.
So it's fatter, but it still has a little of the brightness.
Right.
So JTM 45s are like that, or 410 basements.
Right.
We're like that too. Mm-hmm. Same basic circuit.
Okay.
So on those kind of amps, if you want to get the rock guitar sound, you got to turn it up and turn the bass off.
Gotcha.
Completely. You know.
Okay. Is there a guitar player that you haven't worked with that you would love to someday work with?
How about?
Think about this.
Yeah, right. I got to think about this. Older player or newer player?
It doesn't matter. Somebody that you go, man, I could really improve this, and it would be a great.
You know, actually, I always wanted to work with Warren DeMartini. Mm-hmm. I haven't. Oh, yeah. I know him. I've met him.
Right, yeah.
I haven't. But that's like an old school player that I would, because right. I've worked for most of the.
I'm surprised the ones. You haven't worked with.
Is, yeah, he's so, never even heard the amp. Yeah. Yeah. So I don't know.
Wow.
I talked to him about hearing it.
Yeah.
But, you know, also maybe Eric Gales. How about that?
Yeah. Oh, my God. He's great.
He's the greatest.
He's a great guitar player. If you guys haven't heard Eric Gales, I mean, he's got a really inspirational story. He went through some tough times. He's a kid from the South. And I've met him, and he's a very spiritually connected guitar player to what he plays. There's no, there's something going on there that's like, you know, he plays as if his life depended on it. And he's got technique like a Bonamassa.
Yeah, but no, but he's fire, yeah. and like really interesting technique.
And I
like,
love Joe. It's not, you know, but Eric is, you know,
another planet.
Sometimes when people are, you know, have had a hard time or whatever, and they get through it, their gratitude and sense of what they put into it, it's the X factor. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a lot of musicians like that. Like, you know, I mean, I hate to say it, but there wouldn't be that song Tears in Heaven without Eric Clapton losing his son. Great tragedy is brought, you know, that's how artists mm-hmm. express themselves, whether they're painters mm-hmm. or whatever. You know, my dad was a printer. He used to do printing for Sweet and Low packets, but he figured out a way to expedite the thing, and it was like that's how he expressed himself, and he was very proud to, like, I don't care what it is, whether you're a musician or UPS driver, whatever, you know, however you apply yourself, if you're proud of something that you do, I think that's a form of art, and Eric Gales has got that going on big time. So,
yeah.
All right. I appreciate everybody coming out.
Thank you, guys.